In September of 2020, Emily found a notice on her front door. She was being evicted.
In April, I lost my job due to COVID. So I'm waiting on unemployment. I can't pay. I'm a mother of a 5-month-old. And then the eviction date came. Sorry. It was a really, really, really scary time.
Since the pandemic took millions of U.S. jobs in March and April, most workers who make more than $20 an hour have been able to keep working or have returned to work. But low-wage workers, the people most likely to be renters instead of homeowners, are also the least likely to have gotten their jobs back, which means that many have started to lose their homes.
They showed me some paper and it said, y'all got 30 minutes to get out.
This is my check, but I ain't making it with $300.
Their stroller now carries their possessions.
I have a roof over my head, but I don't know how long that's gonna be.
America is in an eviction crisis, in the middle of a pandemic, but also in the middle of an election. So what can the U.S. do about it? Even before COVID, the U.S. had a much higher eviction rate than similar countries. 1 in 40 renters in the U.S. have been evicted at some point, compared to 1 in 89 in the U.K., 1 in 227 in Denmark, and 1 in 25,000 in France.
What a lot of people don't realize is that we were already in the midst of a housing crisis before COVID-19 hit the United States.
Aliza Durana collects data on evictions for a Princeton University research project called the Eviction Lab.
When we think about difficulty in finding an affordable place to live, one factor is that wages have stagnated for the last several decades.
Since 2001, rents across the U.S. have soared, but the average household income has barely increased at all. This gap represents millions of Americans struggling to pay rent. And that was before they lost their jobs. When the pandemic hit the UK, France, Denmark, and many similar countries, their national governments kept workers afloat while businesses were closed by directly paying everyone a portion of their salary. In the US, Congress approved temporary extra unemployment money back in March. In some states, Republican lawmakers made that money really hard to get. But for those who got it, that money made it possible for people who've been laid off to keep paying their rent. Then in July, the payments stopped. Without that extra cash, lots of unemployed people couldn't pay their rent, and landlords across the country started filing evictions. Over the next few months, Democrats in Congress kept trying to pass extra relief, and Republicans kept saying no. In September, amid damaging headlines and sinking poll numbers, President Trump asked the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention to issue a temporary halt in residential evictions. But it wasn't quite that simple. For the order to protect you from being evicted, you had to fill out a form, certifying under penalty of perjury that you'd tried to get government assistance and make partial payments, among other things. And you'd have to find out about that form on your own. Landlords and housing courts weren't required to tell tenants about it. Emily filled out the form and brought it to her eviction hearing.
They didn't even ask for this declaration. They looked at my landlord and said, "What would you like to do?" And they, of course, said, "We would like to move forward with the eviction."
You know, I talked about one of the reasons I was running.
In an interview on Snapchat in May, former Vice President Joe Biden said this.
There should be rent forgiveness and there should be mortgage forgiveness now in the middle of this crisis.
Since then, some Democrats in Congress have put forward a rent and mortgage cancellation bill that would accomplish what Biden described. It would relieve tenants of the burden of any rental debt accumulated during the pandemic. Instead, their landlords could apply for reimbursement from the federal government. As a longer-term fix to the affordable housing crisis, Biden has also proposed expanding vouchers that help people pay rent. Right now, about 5 million households receive the vouchers. Under Biden's plan, about 16 million would. Evictions don't affect all groups of Americans equally. Black and Latinx Americans are more likely than white Americans to rent, and more likely to be paid poverty wages for their work. The CDC moratorium on evictions is set to expire on December 31st. After that, if nothing changes, millions of renters could be right back where they started.
That is a choice that we're making. In our current historic moment, we should really question why this is happening and reevaluate the idea of housing as a human right and how we can put that into practice.
Thank you for watching this final episode in our 2020 election series. For this project, we asked you what issues we should cover, and a lot of you asked about this one. Patrick wants to know, how will the candidates help hundreds of thousands of people about to be evicted from their homes and the millions more who are barely hanging on? Rachel asks, what will the candidates do to address the lack of affordable housing and the growing eviction problem that exacerbates cycles of poverty? And Nayam wants to know, how will the U.S. government help those getting evicted during the COVID-19 pandemic? Over 14,000 of you wrote to tell us what you thought the most important issues were. We turned some of the most common responses into 9 videos. You can watch them all at vox.com/election videos. Thank you so much for sticking with us.